Welcome to this build review of the FA-18E Super Hornet from Revell in 1/44th scale. This is how it looks, and now I will show you how I built this little diorama using LEDs and the small display base. I started with the cockpit, which is quite good for this small scale. I painted everything with a fine brush and used the kit's decals for the instruments. Next, I continued with the nose and the air intakes. Even these intake fans are modeled, which is a nice detail. I glued the intakes onto the fuselage and closed the landing gear base. Then the pylons were mounted. When the overall assembly was done, I primed it with Ammo of Mix one-shot primer. Then I sprayed the underside with Light Compass Ghost Grey or FS36375 as suggested by the manual. I worked in thin layers and gave it plenty of time to dry. For the upper side, FS36320 or Dark Compass Ghost Grey was used. Again, I tried to do a marbling coat, but had some problems with my airbrush, so I just couldn't do it the way I wanted to. The issue seems to be that the paint dries too quickly, blocking the nozzle. To encounter this problem, I ordered some drying retarder. We will see if that works on my next model. Anyways, I continued with the armament. This kit comes with GBU-31 and Mark 83 bombs, as well as the usual air-to-air armament consisting of MRAMs and sidewinders, and also fuel tanks. There was quite some masking and detail painting involved here, but I don't want to go into detail too much. There are also some decals for the weapons, which were quite fiddly, but with a lot of patience and setting solution, it worked out in the end. Sometimes you just have to improvise a bit with these kits to make life easier. For example, there were decals that have to be folded over the flaps. After I almost lost my nerve because they wouldn't stay in place, I simply masked this area and painted it with the airbrush. Another issue were the Tomcatter's insignia on the fuel tank. It took quite some time to align them on both sides without ripping them apart. This large decal on top of the Super Hornet was also tricky because you have to push an antenna through a small hole in the decal. After I had finally put on most of the decals, I took the pilot from my Trumpeter F1117 kit. He was a bit too large, so I had to do some modifications to get him into the cockpit. I wanted to display the Super Hornet in low flight, so I used the ground blur display base from Coastal Kits. What I had also planned for a while was the usage of LEDs, so I drilled the engine nozzles and used this acrylic ear gauge taper and plug stretching kits mixed color ear flash tunnel expansion body piercing jewelry. Wow, that's a long word. You can get these very cheap from China, and luckily they are shaped like little afterburners. They come in different sizes, and I think this is the closest you can get to reality. I did not really have much experience with electronics, so I did a lot of dry fitting and adjustments, but the initial impression of the effect was positive, so I drilled a small hole for the cables. Later on, I airbrushed these afterburners with a thin layer of orange and decided to use two instead of just one LED. What I couldn't achieve was the recreation of the position and formation lights. That might be something for a larger kit, but with thin wings like these, I did not want to risk drilling more holes. I used some pre-wired LEDs with resistors and an even smaller SMD because I wanted to have a missile shooting off the pylon. It was quite a struggle to tuck the LEDs and cables into this small space. As you can see, I fixed the LEDs with PetaFix, which is quite similar to BlueTech. The SMD comes out of the wing root, where I also had to do some adjustments so there wouldn't be a visible gap after assembly. I did one last test before gluing the fuselage together. Now there was no way back, but I was finally able to close the cockpit, but before that I built a tiny little head-up display out of the flash from a clear sprue that I sprayed with clear green. I used white glue for the clear parts because it dries transparent. As with the rest of the kit, the fit of the canopy was excellent. Masking wasn't needed because there are decals for the canopy as well. This decal was probably the most difficult part of the whole kit. You have to be very precise with the alignment in front of the canopy. It was a real struggle to get it in the right position and achieve a smooth transition to the other decals. Now all the decals were done, it was time for some weathering. I think I used brown enamel paint and smeared it across the surfaces where you can expect weathering on a Hornet. As you can see, the weathering process is always a lot of improvisation when I do it, but thankfully I was able to rub most of the paint off with a cotton bud and white spirit. The effect wasn't as subtle as I wanted it to be, but after completing all the other necessary steps, it toned down and I quite like it. Next, I did a panel line wash to highlight those. Modelers are always arguing about the realism of these effects. While I don't think it's realistic for most vehicles, especially modern fighter jets, it still adds more depth to them, and you can always do it more subtle than I did. Now that the aircraft was pretty much finished, I added the loadout. First, the centerline fuel tank with the Tomcatters lettering. Then the GBU-31s and the Mark 83 bombs. Before mounting the missiles, I drilled small holes to imitate their engine nozzles. I glued one MRAM in place and added two AIM-9X sidewinders on the wingtips. Then it was time to build a compartment for the battery case and the on-off switch. I simply used balsa wood and styrofoam to build this box, which has roughly the same size as the display base. Before fixing the aircraft to the base, I had to mask the canopy with masking liquid, so I could spray some semi-gloss varnish on it without troubles. Finally, I glued the nozzles with these acrylic earring afterburners in place. I drilled a hole into the base and threaded the cables through a bamboo straw. I couldn't find anything better, but I think it kind of matches the color of the ground base, so it's okay. The straw was glued in place with super glue, so I was able to wire up the battery compartment and switch with the two LEDs and the SMD. Last but not least, I took some cotton to recreate smoke from the launching missile. In my opinion, a lighter works best to bring the cotton in the right shape. I airbrushed it in orange and dark gray. Then I attached the AIM-120 and also added a tiny acrylic earring thingy. I wrapped the cotton smoke around everything to hide the cable, and that's it. A lot of work went into editing all the video files and pictures. Here you can see how I edit out the background and do some other adjustments. On some close-up photos, I improved the smoke of the missile because you can see the individual fibers of the cotton and it just looks much better after smoothing that out. Also, you can see every single dust particle and tiny scratches in those macro shots, but these are quite easy to remove in the program paint.net. As you can see, I also tried to remove the straw, which was quite a learning process because I'm not that experienced with image editing. I just wanted to show you that so you know that most of the work begins once the kit is finished. Actually, I need even more time to cut and edit the respective video together than building and painting. I don't want my videos to be too long because personally I simply switch off videos that are longer than 15 or 20 minutes or I watch them at double the speed. What's your opinion about video length? In the case of the Super Hornet, it was more work to take good photos and edit them. I took most photos in complete darkness with long exposure times to get the best effects from the LEDs. Overall, I think it was quite a good idea to add the afterburners and missile. Obviously, it's not 100% realistic, but on the other hand, I couldn't find a more realistic method. I might try this again with a 70-second scale kit. What do you think? Can you come up with a different method to recreate afterburners? Tell me in the comments below and also take a look on my Facebook page. Starfish scale modeling. What I nearly forgot to mention here was how good this kit actually is. I saw much worse kits in the past, especially from Revell, but this one went together so nicely that I got myself two more 1/44th scale kits from a sale. And I still have this 70-second scale Super Hornet from Italeri in my stash. So I hope you like the outcome and appreciate my hard work with a like and a subscription. Leave me some feedback in the comments and share the video. If you want to support this small channel, check out the links in the description. Thanks a lot for watching and have a nice day.